What a glorious day. We're so excited that you're here. I'm excited to be here. Nettie and I, what she said is, Janice, I just want you to get up there, girl, and just warm them up a little bit. I said, I can do that. Nettie and I have known each other so long. When I first met her, I didn't have gray hair, glasses, and I was a size 10. Okay, probably a size 12, but we're not counting. I always say that she's my sister from another mother, but we got the same father. Amen. Oh my gosh, we've had so much fun. Nettie and I, we've known each other about 10 years or more. And I used to live across the street from her last year. And we'd work out at the gym a couple times during the week. We'd have more fun. We'd share, we'd laugh, we'd sing. We taught, we did the jail ministry together. We got to talk about how rich it was to see these women's lives change and how wonderful it was just to be able to be a part of that. Amen. And so we'd laugh, and there was twice when she saved my life at that gym. I'll tell you why. Because that treadmill tried to kill me twice. It did. I'd be just briskly walking, and we'd be talking and laughing, and all of a sudden that thing would stop in midair. I did one of those. It wasn't real pretty that morning either. But she caught me twice in midair. Saved my life. I said, girl, you're in my will. You're not going to get much because I only got a single wide trailer, but hey, that's okay. First time I got to sing with Nettie, I'll never forget it. It was a wonderful time. She's so powerful, and she's the real deal, right? Her and Coca-Cola are the real thing. Yep, she's all that in a bag of Lay's potato chips. And this girl, she can blow, let me tell you. So it's always an honor to get to sing with her, get to stand up next and share, you know, ministry with Lynette together. So Pastor John had us singing some kind of a soulful song. You know, that's what she does, you know. I had to channel my inner soul sister. Ooh, yeah. And I was going to town for all it's worth. I don't even remember what the song was, but I do remember this. You can always tell when someone's staring at you, right? I looked over at Nettie, and she's like this, looking down at me, and I thought, ruh-roh, I must have been a little bit overboard. But, you know, I looked back at her, and she goes, girl, you get down with your bad self. I knew right then we were going to be fast buds, and we were. We were good friends for a long, long time. What a joy it was to share in ministry. So I'm a lot of breath. Sorry about that. When we were working on the treadmill together, I heard for the last year all about Charles. Charles is Charles. Lord have mercy. Charles could do no wrong, honey. Should have seen the email I got from Charles. Should have seen what Charles brought me today. She first told me about him. She says, girl, I found me a little white dude. I said, you found a what? You found a white sweater with a hood? She goes, no, I found a white dude. I said, well, put him back. What do you mean you found him? Where was he? Put him back. She goes, no, he's good. He loves Jesus. He's a good guy. He loves the Lord with all his heart. You know, Nettie does too. She just loves the Lord. She's faithful. She's dedicated. She's the kind of girl you want to have in your life. That's the kind of girl he's got today. He's got a girl that's going to join with him in prayer, and they're going to be a mighty force in God. Amen. If they pray together, a couple that prays together, amen. They're going to have a long life together. We're so excited that they're joining in Jesus today. So, yeah. I'm out of breath, Pastor. I haven't done this in a while. But, so I remember the day that she got engaged. I said, Nettie, you're what? She goes, oh, honey, I got myself a ring. He put a ring on it. She was so excited. I said, well, that's great. And then the day came when she had to go get her gown. Lord, that's all I heard about for weeks before. I'm going to get my gown. I got to keep working on this treadmill to fit into my gown. Girl, I got to look good. So I said, I know, I agree. And so the day she went to go get her gown, I'll never forget that day. It was etched in my memory forever. That was the day I set her kitchen on fire. Well, I didn't mean to. It wasn't my fault. It's Pastor Karen's fault, actually, because she had me cooking for the missionaries. Now, you know the missionaries can eat. And I had a 40-pound sack of potatoes. It took me an hour to peel those puppies, you know. But she had this pot that was like way big. So I peeled those, put them on the stove, and she left. So then I turned on the, you know, the burner, turned around, started making my green bean almondine, and I hear, whoosh. I turned around. There was a 3-alarm fire going on in her kitchen, and she wasn't home. And I'm sitting there going, Lord, Lord. But anyway, she came home. She was so excited. I cleaned everything up. And I said, how'd it go? How'd your dress look? What, you know, how many people came? How you doing? She goes, oh, girl, it's so beautiful, and blah, blah, blah. We talked about, I was just trying to warm her up before I told her the bad news. So then I said, she goes, oh, it smells so good in here. You know, she's a good cook. This girl can cook now, let me tell you. Charles ain't ever going to go hungry. So she goes, oh, it smells so good. I said, I know. I said, I got the garlic mashed potatoes done. I said, the green bean almondines are almost done. Chicken's in the oven, and I put the fire out. Yeah, she yelled like real loud, what? But it was all good. I want to tell you that Nettie's been there in my life many times. If you need someone to pray over you, that's the kind of girl you need to join forces with. And that's the kind of support you need in your life. You need someone who's going to grab a hold of the horns of the altar and just go to prayer for you, right? And that's my girl. I said, one day I was laying in ICU. I hadn't told anybody I was there. And they put me on Dilaudid, and the walls were moving. You know what I mean? This stuff was powerful. And so I heard this. Uh-uh. Oh, no, devil. Now, my glasses were off, and I looked left to the wall. It wasn't that pretty that day either. I looked to the left. There was the walls. And when I turned to the right, what I saw was my girl. She used to have this hairdo. It had a zip code all its own. It was big. But I recognized her coming through that door, and she was coming to do some damage. Oh, no, she said, no, devil, in the name of Jesus. And she started praying for me and wanted to raise me up out of that bed. By faith, God did it. Amen. That's the kind of girl she is. Yeah. Charles needs prayer. That girl's not going to ask who, what, when, where, or why. She's not going to say, was it rainy or was it cloudy? And what were you wearing in a Z formation? She's just going to say, Father God, right now in the name of Jesus, I don't know what's happening, but you do, Lord, and I'm going to come in agreement right now in Jesus' name. That's the kind of girl Nettie is. She doesn't ask you what's going on, how many people were there, and what were their names. She just comes in prayer. And that's who you need to join forces with, someone who knows how to pray and agree with you in prayer for your circumstances and situations. So we've had a lot of good times together. And Charles has got a great girl. She's going to stand by him all the days of his life. If he loves her, cherishes her, honors her in the way that God wants him to do, just like Jesus did to the church. She's going to be by him, by his side, through thick and thin. Amen? Yep. And the same for him. I know he will. And she's just going to be, because she's like a young girl in school going to her first prom, you know, oh, Charles this and Charles that, you know. So I can just imagine how gorgeous she looks today, because she is all prepped. She's ready to come on out, right? This is her day. This isn't Charles' day. It's her day. All he has to do is come with some spit shine shoes, maybe a new suit, got a ring in one pocket and a tic-tac in the other. Yeah. Because it's fixing to go down here in about 5. So he's going to have to pop that tic-tac. So, yeah, this girl is so happy. She's been looking forward to this for a year. And what she's going to do with him today is she's going to lock arms with him. Two flesh are coming in, and they're going out one flesh today. Yeah. They're going to stand by each other. No woman's going to get in between them. No devil with his plans is going to come and tear down any plan that God has. Because if they're a praying couple together, they're going to stay together. And I know they will. The other thing she's going to do for him, she's going to stand in front of him. You want to get to Charles, you got to go through her. And if she does the same thing for him, they're going to have a powerful marriage for the rest of their days. Amen. The other thing she's going to do, she's going to sing over him with that voice. That voice of joy. Oh, man, it's so good. Powerful, anointed. And she's not joking. She's not kidding. She's the real deal. And it's powerful. And I can hear her now. Father God, bless my husband as he goes out that door, Father God. Every step he takes, Father God, lead him, guide him. Be before him, behind him, over him, cover over him, right? That's what she does. She knows the word, but she knows the God who gave her that word to use for the glory. Amen. Yeah. The other thing she's going to do is she's going to stand behind him. No fiery darts. The enemy is going to come and penetrate his back. There ain't going to be any kind of stabbing in the back, because she's going to be right there. He's going to do the same thing for her. It's going to be a powerful union in God. Amen? What a great day. So glad to see you guys here. I'm excited. Charles, you can go ahead and pop that tic-tac now, because we're about ready for the nuptials. Let's give Pastor Nick a hand as he comes and leads this couple into mighty moment. Give her the mic. Oh. Thank you.
Suddenly, everything was right. All of her fears, all of her years, alone. Can it be she is now his own? His journey's end. Here we are. Together they have found a dream come true. With the pledge of love between them, they can finally say, I do. Here we are. A love to last their whole life. Charles and Lynn together, here we are. Charles and Lynn forever, here we are.
Dearly beloved, we're gathered here in the sight of God and in the sight of this company to join together this man and woman in holy matrimony, which is commended of St. Paul to be honorable among all men, and therefore is not to be entered into unadvisedly or lightly, but reverently, discreetly, advisedly, and in the fear of the Lord. Into this holy estate, these two persons present come now to be joined. Charles, will you receive Lynette to be your lawfully wedded wife, to live together according to God's word in the holy state of matrimony? Will you nourish and cherish her as your own flesh and love her as Christ loved the church, giving yourself for her to protect, provide, and care for her all the days of your life and be joined together as one in the Lord?
I will.
Lynette, will you receive Charles to be your lawfully wedded husband, to live together according to God's word in the holy state of matrimony? Will you submit him as to the Lord and make him the head of this union under God, even as Christ is the head of the church? Will you love him and care for him all the days of your life and be joined together as one in the Lord? We've gathered here today to witness the uniting of Charles and Lynette in holy matrimony. The Bible describes the kind of love that it will require for a man and a woman entering into the covenant relationship we call marriage. The Apostle Paul wrote of this love in his letter to the Corinthians. Let me quote from this great text as he describes the quality of love that will make this union all God intends it to be. Listen with me. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself, is not puffed up, does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. And now abides faith, hope, and love, these three, but the greatest of these is love. The kind of love described here is found in the person of Jesus Christ, for God is love. And he who has the Son has the capacity to love like him. So as you daily yield your lives to Jesus Christ, and let me tell you, that's really where it begins. Each day, start out your day with Jesus. Each day, offer yourself to him. Each day, ask Jesus to come and fill you with his life and his love. And then you're going to have something to give to one another. A marriage that is built on the foundation of the love of God will last a lifetime and bring you all the fulfillment and the joy you desire this day. Would you turn and face one another and join your hands together and exchange your vows? You take your time. Charles, if you would, repeat after me. I, Charles, receive thee, Lynette, to my wedded wife, to have and to hold, from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, till death do us part, according to God's holy word. And therefore, I pledge thee my love and faithfulness. Lynette, if you would, repeat after me. I, Lynette,
receive thee, Charles,
to my wedded husband, to have and to hold,
from this day forward,
for better, for worse,
for richer, for poorer,
in sickness and in health,
to love, cherish, and obey,
till death do us part, according to God's holy word. And therefore, I pledge thee my love and faithfulness. May I have the rings, please? The circle is the emblem of eternity, and gold is a symbol of what's least tarnished and most enduring. A ring is a circle with no place of ending. This symbolizes two things. First, the love of God for you, which has no beginning and no ending. For Scripture declares, nothing can ever separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Secondly, the ring symbolizes your commitment to a never-ending love for one another. Just as the ring is an unbroken circle, so it is God's will that your union be unbroken except by death. Your rings are made of precious metal, least tarnished, symbolizing the love between you, which will never grow old. These rings are reminders of that inner bond which joins your hearts together as one. They are symbols of your union with one another and of the love of God for you. This is a love that grows and matures as the years pass. This is a love that stands in adversity. It's a love that lifts you above circumstances. It's a love that overcomes every problem, soothes every heartache, and calms every fear. Nothing can ever separate you from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Let nothing ever separate you from the love which God has given you to share with one another. Charles, if you would take this ring and place it on the third finger of Lynette's left hand, and as you do, repeat after me. As a pledge, and in token of the covenant between us made, with this ring, I thee wed, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lynette, if you would take this and place it on the third finger of Charles' left hand, and as you do, repeat after me. As a pledge, and in token of the covenant between us made, with this ring, I thee wed. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Turn and face me. Hook up. There you go. As we're witnessing this covenant of marriage, we're reminded of another covenant that our Lord and Savior completed by his death and resurrection. Pointing to this eternal covenant just before his death, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the same manner, also he took the cup, saying, "This is the New Testament of my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Known Lynette for quite some time, Charles, I just met, but we spent a lot of time together. We did some premarital preparation, and it was there that I came to know Charles and to know that he has a deep, abiding love for the Lord Jesus Christ and a desire to want to live to please him. Wasn't always like that, but there came a day when he came to faith in Christ. Lynette's got a story. She ought to write a book. Maybe one day she will. But here's a lady who loves God and desires with all her heart to live to please him and to glorify his name through all the gifts that he's given her, and he's given her many. So they stand before us today as a testimony, first of the love of God, because it was God's love that brought you to this place today. And then it was God's love that he's given you to share with one another. And so as you celebrate the covenant of your marriage, you're celebrating the covenant that you have with the Lord Jesus Christ, because you know that he's the giver of life. He's the one who gives you life, not only now in this life, but in the life to come. Jesus said, "I've come to give you life and life more abundantly," and that's what God has given you. But I know also that there are some of you folk that are here today, and maybe you don't come to church very often. Maybe it's weddings and funerals are the only reason why you might come. But Charles and Lynette wanted me to make sure you knew that it was Jesus that loved you and brought you here today, and that he wants very much for you to know his love and share his love. Maybe some of you were raised in church traditions, but you've gotten away from it, and life took its twists and turns and just caused you to stray. Well, he's calling you back home today. He really wants you to know him and to live for him and love him. And his love in you is powerful. It's life-changing. And it's the only thing that can ultimately bring satisfaction in your life. There was a moment in time in different places at different times when both Charles and Lynette recognized their need of Jesus, recognized that they were sinners in need of a Savior and they couldn't save themselves, but understood that it was Jesus who died on the cross to pay sin's price so that they could have life with him. And they simply acknowledge that by saying, God, I need you in my life. Come, forgive me of my sins. Be my Lord and Savior. And in that simple prayer of faith, God heard them and answered them, and they began their spiritual journey with Jesus, and culminating today in the celebration of the covenant of love that God's given them to share with one another. So as Charles and Lynette receive the elements of communion, I invite you to examine yourself. If you're in a good place with God, then you're celebrating. But if things aren't where they need to be and you know it, then just whisper a prayer to Jesus. Lord, I want your love in my heart again. I want to surrender my life to you. And he will hear you and he will answer you. And his love will make all the difference in your life. Let's partake of communion. But Lord Jesus, we thank you. Thank you for the body of Christ, which was broken for us. Thank you, Lord, for the bread of life that feeds our hungry souls. Lord, we receive you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the cup of the covenant. Thank you for your shed blood, which cleanses us, removes the stain of every sin, brings us in right relationship with you, and is sealed, Lord, with your very own blood. There are great and precious promises in your word, Lord, that we stand on today that you will fulfill just as they are written. And we look forward to the day when we'll drink this cup with you in your presence. Lord, by partaking of the bread and of the fruit of the vine, we proclaim your death until you come. Come quickly, Lord Jesus. For as much as Charles and Lynette have mutually entered into this holy covenant of marriage and have witnessed the same before God in this company and have pledged their love and faithfulness to one another and have declared the same by giving and receiving a ring, I pronounce that they are husband and wife in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Father, I thank you, God, for your hand on Charles and Lynette. I thank you, Lord, for the gift you've given them to share. Let that love grow stronger in them, stronger love for you and for one another as the days pass. I pray, Lord God, that you would bless and prosper them in all they put their hands to, that they would know good health, Lord, and fruitfulness in their life in every way, and that you would use them, Lord, that the testimony of their lives and their marriage would display your grace and love to the world around them. And so, Father, I pray blessing and peace and prosperity and protection and good health in the name of Jesus Christ. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you and keep you as one. May the love of God be before you peaceful, behind you peaceful, and all around you peaceful. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Charles, you may kiss your bride. Give her flowers back. If you would, turn and face the congregation. It gives me a great deal of pleasure to have the honor of presenting to you Mr. and Mrs. Charles Miller. of the family, I want to thank you for coming and celebrating with us. There is a cake and punch reception across the hall in our cafe, and we would ask you to go there now. And the family members who are supposed to be in pictures, those of you that were told to stay back for pictures.
Before you go, could I just get a shot of the whole crowd clapping as if they were still up here?
I'm sorry. All right, you are dismissed. Thank you for coming. God bless you. We'll see you at the reception.